For all incisions, the same operative principles apply. Pre-measured implant size, predetermined nipple to inframammary fold distance, precise muscle release, preservation of the pectoralis major muscle along the lateral sternal border, preservation of the fibrous interface between parenchyma and pectoralis, and for sure, all these steps are done with precise post-operative hemostasis. Since the scar must be within the new inframammary fold, that location must be accurately determined before surgery. In general, the standard of 7 cm for a base width of 11 cm, 8 cm for a base width of 12 cm, and 9 cm for a base width of 13 cm holds true. After the section according to the plane selected, gloves are changed, and implants are gently inserted. If the incision is too small to atraumatically place the implant, the incision can be enlarged. The patient is then elevated to a sitting position for inspection of the breasts. Particular attention should be placed to the inframammary folds and lateral breast pocket. Although insertion funnels are considered both cost prohibitive and unnecessary, there are advantages to using them. First, their general utility improves as implant size increases. They can mitigate implant size restrictions when small diameter areolas are used for pocket access. Also, they can make normal incision lengths possible while minimizing the prospect of gel fracture. Finally, in case of significant volume asymmetry, where placement of multiple silicone sizers can be a useful aid to accurate implant selection, they both greatly reduce repetitive insertion trauma that may contribute to capsular contracture development while also helping to maintain maximum sterility. In addition, it has been shown that the use of funnels decreases exposure to bacteria contamination by reducing skin contact with the implant. And finally, the incisions are closed with attention at all times directed to avoiding any contact between the needle and the implant, as even small shell injury may increase the chance of subsequent shell failure. Skin closure should be meticulous and atraumatic to the skin edges to achieve an optimal scar result. With precise visualization of the pocket, no special bra or straps are necessary to push the implant into position to prevent it from moving out of position. tape or a steel strip over the incision is the only dressing that is used. With bloodless dissection, no special bandage are necessary to create compression. Early motion is not just allowed, it's ordered. Patients move their arms over their head in the recovery room in a slow jumping jack type of motion. Patients are encouraged to perform all normal daily activities that don't involve strain or exertion, such as opening and closing car doors, putting on a seat belt, lifting a baby, emptying a dishwasher, or making dinner. They may drive a car in 2 to 3 days. They may return to the gym after 3 weeks. Regular MRI or ultrasound screenings should be carried out to assess the breast implants. Numerous factors contribute to complications and patient dissatisfaction in breast augmentation. Unrealistic goals, suboptimal implant selection, non-ideal surgical plan, healing problems, patient non-compliance with instructions, change in body habitus, device inadequacies, and disorders of healing and patient biology. Post-operative complications can be categorized into possible complications inherent to all breast surgery, including bleeding, reported to occur at an incidence of about 1%. In case of heavy bleeding, it's necessary to return to the operating room, drain the blood, and put a stop to the bleeding. Serous effusion. This means an accumulation of lymphatic liquid around the implant. It gives rise to a temporary increase in the volume of the breast or breasts. It decreases gradually and disappears. Infection after augmentation mammoplasty is rare, but it cannot be treated simply by antibiotics and requires the removal of the implant for several months following drainage. Skin necrosis that can be favored by high blood pressure, hematoma, an infection, or heavy smoking by the patient. A second operation is often required, with possibly the need to remove the implant. Abnormal scar, where the healing process is unpredictable and scars can be less discreet than expected. They can be widened, retractile, hyper or hypopigmented, hypertrophic, or rarely keloid. Also, sensory changes can be frequently found in the first few months, but usually diminished over time. Galactorrhea or milk secretion, where very rare cases of unexplained postoperative hormonal stimulation have been reported. And also pneumothorax, though very rare, but it has specific own management. The second category of complications include specific implant-related risks. In the form of wrinkling or rippling, the outer envelope of the implant can form creases, which can be palpable or visible under the skin. It's common in thin patients and may be treated with biomodeling. Capsular contracture is the most common and severe complications associated with breast implants. It's a normal physiological reaction that the fibrous shell should develop around an implant. Normally, this membrane is thin, supple, and imperceptible, but the reaction can increase and the capsule can thicken, become fibrous, and contract, exerting pressure on the implant. It is seen known as contracture. Capsular contraction can follow infection or a hematoma, but often has no determined cause, resulting from unpredictable organic reaction. If necessary, the capsule can be incised in a surgical procedure called capsulotomy. Implant rupture or shell failure, where an implant can become porous and the silicone envelope of the implant can deteriorate. If the implant is filled with physiologic solution, the implant will deflate partially or totally, suddenly or slowly. But with silicone gel, this will remain inside the membrane surrounding the implant. This can cause capsule formation or can remain unnoticed. That's called silent rupture. Rupture of the implants usually require an operation to change them. Bad positioning or movement of the implant. Where an error in the original position of the implant or an implant which moves can affect the shape of the breast and require corrective surgery. Turning, though it happens rarely, and anatomical style implants can in theory tear, thus affecting the shape of the breast. Malformation of the thoracic cage can occur in very rare cases when a hard fibrous capsule has formed and been left for a long time. Its shape may imprint on the tissues, leaving a malformation which is difficult to correct. Late onset seroma, where in extremely rare cases, a collection of liquid can form around an implant after some years. This requires a sample being taken guided ultrasound and bacteriologic and cytology test carried out. It's also important to keep in mind that breast implants don't increase the incidence of breast cancer. One large registry showed a lower incidence of breast cancer. In recent years, a new entity has been recognized that can arise within the capsular tissue. That's called Brody's disease. That is a T-cell anaplastic large cell lymphoma arising in the breast implant capsule. Other less common complications include asymmetry, immune response, lymph node enlargement, stretch marks, calcification in scar tissue, and artificial appearance, especially for very slim patients, where the upper limit of the implant is visible.